Hi, everyone. I'm Ester De Nicolas Benito, Senior Director of the Strategic Missions and Technologies team here at Microsoft. Earlier today, Microsoft announced a strategic co-innovation collaboration with Photonic, a company focused on building scalable, fault-tolerant, and distributed quantum technologies. Our shared mission is to advance the next stages in quantum networking and empower the quantum ecosystem with new capabilities enabled by our unique and complementary approaches to scalable quantum infrastructure. To share more about this collaboration, I'm very excited to be joined by Dr. Stephanie Simmons, Chief Quantum Officer and founder of Photonic, and Jason Zander, who is the Executive Vice President of the Strategic Missions and Technologies team at Microsoft. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you so much for having us.
Yeah, very great to be here. Thank you.
I appreciate you both taking the time to be here with our community. It is such an exciting time to be working in quantum technologies right now. The progress is extremely encouraging. And I want to start with you, Steph, because I'm intrigued by, you know, your history. Like, what drew you into this field of quantum information sciences in the first place?
Oh, thank you. Thank you for asking. Yeah, as it happens, I came across the concept of quantum technologies when I was 16, and I fell in love, and I never looked back. Usually there's something that brings people into STEM, but this one is just so fascinating. And when you think about it, it actually is it's part of a longer trajectory in terms of how humans evolve technology, right? It's all about bringing physics, right? Something truly experimental into users' hands, right? Commercializing branches of physics. And I was being brought up, I was coding a lot on our little old computers, yes, Microsoft, back in the early 90s. And I just recognized how much this is going to change if we can do the next, bring the next wave of computing capabilities. So yeah, I kind of got sucked in really early, and it's just been such a fascinating journey.
So now, Jason, let me ask you something. What about this chapter of the quantum evolution feels the most exciting to you?
I think it's just a fantastic area. We believe that we can really fundamentally accelerate scientific discovery. And if I think about it, the world needs that more than ever today. If I think about energy and sustainability, can we create better batteries? Can we figure out ways to create, you know, kind of green energy sources that we don't have today? Can we help with global warming, get rid of forever chemicals and things that are toxic to the environment? And the cool thing about this is we can start today. We have awesome support with HPC and AI that we can be leveraging right now. And as we're building computers with Photonic, and you know, as they come along, we get to the supercomputers, they're going to add even more on top of that. So it all accrues towards that kind of future.
I absolutely agree. I think those are the first early targets. The one thing that I focus on individually is I think the catalyst is a really important one. If we're going to have to redefine a whole bunch of energy products and thinking about how we do, yes, consumer goods and the rest of it. At the moment, we don't have tools fit for purpose, right? For catalysts, there's just no way the quantum mechanics of those chemical processes are just outside the scope of what can be done with classical systems at now. So if we can unlock that and actually have design tools for all of chemistry and all of materials, I mean, what is that going to enable? And the other thing is, you don't always know in advance just how far a particular branch of physics will go. So we were sharing earlier that what they thought of was going to be the killer app, as it were, for semiconductor physics, right? Transistors. They thought the killer app was going to be hearing aids. They weren't they didn't think about Microsoft or any of these other app, or AI for that matter. Right? But they were thinking about hearing it. So there is going to be a lot of other opportunities that we've yet to identify because these tools are only just coming online at the moment.
What's fascinating to me, I'm glad you mentioned that reference, because I believe we're in the 75th year of the transistor being discovered. And here we are 75 years later, and it's still at the cornerstone of like the technology industry. And so if I think what's going to be 75 years from now, 100 years from now, all the computers and the technology that we're building now, I think it's also still going to be a cornerstone. And a lot of technology will come and go. It seems super popular now. But what is that enduring value that comes? This genuine scientific discovery and things that can help that pivot. Wow, that's something that I think is going to have just decades to centuries worth of value.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
I have goosebumps. So let's talk about the collaboration. Steph, why this collaboration between Microsoft and Photonic, and why now?
I think it's been very clear over the past couple of decades that Microsoft is committed to quantum supercomputing and thinking big picture and thinking about big impact. And that's also been how our approach has been evolving over the last while. We're absolutely committed to that large scale customer value, unlocking real wins for the globe. And because of that big impact picture, that alignment in the way that we're thinking about it, it makes sense to go faster together. It just makes sense to go faster together, because the sooner we can get those tools up and running and available to as many different industries as possible, the more we get to all benefit. So it absolutely makes sense to accelerate efforts by bringing this together.
100% agree. We have very complementary teams and skill sets, which I think is awesome. And there's some amazing technology that Steph and team are building that we definitely want to have this collaboration for. If I think about it, part of our goal at Microsoft is we're also creating an ecosystem. So we are a platform company as well. If you think about hyperscale cloud and the software platforms, we want to make sure that we're constantly bringing in the best technology that's available to our customers. That means we're going to engage in hardware solutions, partners, et cetera. And Photonic is just a natural fit for us. And in particular, a place that Photonic is just heads and shoulders above everyone else is their networking. And I think about that as super complementary, because just the spin photonics, I mean, it's right in the name. I mean, the opportunity to be able to do something that is a native fit for networking technology is amazing. We can unlock and accelerate new roadmaps around that, you know, frankly, just aren't there today. And I think it's becoming an area of huge focus. So think about computing, networking. We're going to get there faster together.
So now, Jason, the team also announced today that Microsoft plans to integrate Photonics' unique quantum hardware into Azure Quantum Elements as it becomes available. Does this collaboration change Microsoft's commitment to topological quantum computing?
The quick and easy answer is no. Doesn't really change the path of discovery. Again, like I mentioned, we're a platform company, so we're going to embrace the best technology along the way. We already have a set of machines that are in Azure Quantum, and we're absolutely looking forward to accelerating and getting the Photonic machines there, because they're going to represent some unique new types of scale and work that we want to have. And it's a great fit for Azure Quantum Elements. The way people should think about it is your data center today has significant amounts of compute and increasing amounts of GPUs, like for AI. We're not going to replace CPUs with GPUs. GPUs are acceleration. You should think of quantum computers as another type of accelerator that we will put into the data centers. It will accelerate certain types of workloads, and then the rest of the data center around us is going to have some huge value. And of course, with the potential for quantum networking, we also have the opportunity to create an underpinning across that same infrastructure. But again, I think the key thing is the Photonic technology, the IP that Steph and team have created, is absolutely brilliant. It's great IP. I love it. We want to help accelerate it. I think it's all going to be quite complementary. And at the end of the day, all of our machines today are kind of in level one for compute. All of us, nobody's past that. But I think we have the opportunity to get to level two, and then of course level three, which is essentially hyperscale, that supercomputer. What is that quantum supercomputer? Millions of logical qubits. We have circuits that we have designed. We're waiting for a machine that can actually run them. And it's going to unlock amazing things like how to do carbon capture and help with climate control and things like that. Can't do that till we get to level three. So we're going to have to keep partnering. We're going to go figure that out. And look, couldn't be happier about the co-innovation work and expanding the ecosystem and the collaboration.
You mentioned these different levels of quantum computing representing where we are and where we're going. And I actually love that stage approach. So I would like to ask you, how do you see this collaboration evolving in the future?
Well, it's really important that we figure out how to continue to mature the technology, because, you know, we want to introduce not only to the computing, but also a new networking paradigm. There's a path to scale there also. And we have all sorts of applications that we'll be able to unlock, et cetera. I think one of the most amazing things about the Photonic IP, and it's just natively built for this, right? If I think about entanglement over long distances, that's really the intrinsic that we're trying to enable. And Photonic is just naturally designed to go do that. It's using the same underlying technology is all the switching, you know, data center, switches that we use today, which is fantastic. Today, we've got some point-to-point and some NISQ solutions, but frankly, not enough that is telecom compatible. That's something else I think we can change. And so the collaboration will really help us accelerate to those next stages.
You're absolutely spot on. We're in an early phase, and the promise there is going global. Like, how do we get from here to there? And so stage one, yes, a bunch of point-to-point links. But what really you get when unlocking greater topologies is you get some kind of hub capability, the ability for lots of users to kind of come together in local area quantum networks. So that would be what I would call stage two, where you get some kind of repeater functionality. This is the key to unlocking that big global scale quantum networking, is reliable quantum repeaters. This has been the holy grail for quantum networking for 20 years. And so, yes, our technology is absolutely squarely focused at delivering entanglement at scale between lots of users, between lots of quantum technology processor units, and also across the globe through long distance links, as you mentioned. So that's the phase three picture, is large scale entanglement distribution. Taking the benefits of a computing framework to networking to solve the greatest challenges in quantum networking, but also using quantum networks to unleash horizontal scale for all kinds of quantum technologies.
So Steph, in addition to being the founder and chief quantum officer at Photonic, you're also the co-chair of Canada's National Quantum Strategy. I would love to understand what is your perspective on the role that governments should play.
This is now going through that industrial phase. And so the role that governments play is quite key in figuring out what kinds of benefits that country gets to accrue from these new technologies. So if you go and you take a look at how lots of technologies have gone through their adoption phase, is that usually there's this mass explosion of interest, and then all of a sudden there's this tipping point where there's this consolidation and there's a mass acquisition spree and a talent shortage. So if you go back and you look at what computing was in the 50s and the 60s, the talent shortage was so acute that people didn't get to benefit from the full weight of that power until much later, until basically the skills were there. So in terms of what the governments can do, governments are key in their role for talent development, not just at the graduate and undergraduate level, but how to think about the systems that best support the industrialization of these things, and how to bring on board the right kind of skills and the right kind of incentives for adoption to make sure that everybody gets to benefit from this. So yeah, no, there's a really important role also, because these things are such powerful technologies. They could be considered dual use technologies, and therefore governments have a really important role to play on the regulatory side to make sure that these things are used ethically and in a way that is in maximal total global benefit. So there's absolutely a role to be played there as well.
Yeah, I fully agree with that. And I think if you look back at the history of some of the best innovations that we've had, it's not any one government or company or university. It's actually the combination of the best academics, the best of public and private partnership. That's what's really unlocked amazing new technologies that have been useful for everyone in multiple different governments, multiple different places around the world. And so the governments therefore do have a very important role to play. In particular, security and innovation, that's something we talk a lot about. Responsible and ethical, responsible computing. Quantum needs to be part of responsible computing. How do we make sure that we can do things that will unlock really cool potential, but do them in a safe way, right? Make sure the ethics are followed along the way. That, again, is a place where government can and should be involved to go create those regulations and the guidelines that are required. And of course, as private industry, we want to work with governments as well. And then, you know, finally, I think there is an opportunity for governments to also start thinking, if we're going to unlock this new innovation, how do you reshape, you know, sectors going forward?
I absolutely agree. Now is absolutely the time to start taking a look at the applications that we already know exist and figuring out what it means for your business, what that means for you, what kind of resources you're going to need, how you can prepare, how do you think about that transition for your organization, because there's a lot of opportunities here. So there's a lot of co-design opportunities with the customers, and we're going to be moving faster together. So it's a good time to get in.
Thank you both so much for this incredible conversation and for sharing more about the collaboration. This was great. And thank you everyone for joining us today. If you would like to learn more about how Microsoft and Photonic will be working together to advance the next stages of quantum networking and empower the quantum ecosystem with new capabilities, you can join us for a special episode of the Quantum Innovator Series on January 31st. We look forward to seeing you there. Thank you.